BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
NAP Connection is a panel discussion on selected art issues with three guests and the host, James Carroll. Home viewers are invited to call and offer comments or questions during the live telecast. NAP Connection is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit art service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. The New Arts Program is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Well, good afternoon, folks. Welcome to NAP Connections. I'm your host, I'm Ron Shire, and with me tonight, I have my very special guest, a painter from the area, from Wyomissing Hills. It's Michele Byrne.
Hello.
And welcome. Welcome to the program.
Thanks for inviting me.
Glad to have you here.
Thank you.
Yes. So Michele's going to talk with us about her artwork and how, you know, and her process and procedures and all that. And, we're just going to learn a little bit more about her than we previously did. So let's just start first by just having a little bit of you saying something about yourself.
Okay. Well, I live in Wyomissing, Pennsylvania. I grew up in Berks County my whole entire life. Mm-hmm. And I've been painting since I was maybe 8 years old. I always loved painting. Mm-hmm. And I remember my kindergarten teacher said, Michele Moyer is a good artist. And mm-hmm. I was like, oh, I want to be an artist. So I went with mm-hmm. it. So I've been painting forever, although I did when I had my kids. Well, after college, I was a graphic designer for 20 years, and then I had my kids, and then when they started getting old enough that they could keep their hands out of paint, mm-hmm. is when I started painting. So I've been doing it, a bit obsessed with it, and that's what I do.
Well, you're good at what you do. So, as a painter, you work solely with oil paints?
Yes, I started out with watercolors, and, I've dabbled in other things, but... Mm-hmm. Pretty much oils, and last couple years with palette knife.
With a palette knife, yeah. So we'll notice that with a lot of these mm-hmm. works, and we'll show you quite a few of them here. But the works are pretty much slash and cut, and mm-hmm. and pretty sharp. But you've got a really good eye for color, and the depth, and surprising to see all of the things that you can accomplish with a palette knife.
Yeah, it's tricky, and I teach palette knife classes, and it's mm-hmm. this really odd tool, it's like, some people call it a spatula. So it's kind of wieldy, mm-hmm. it's like long, and mm-hmm. you have to practice a lot. So I teach it, and people think you can just take a class and learn it, but just to practice, and mm-hmm. which I've done, and I wasn't so good at it in the beginning either, so.
Well, it tends to, you do a lot of mixing and color choices right on the surface of your of your work.
Right.
So sometimes it's just that it just takes a really good eye for this type of thing, so that when you do come up with it, it's like you see the colors as they're being put down.
Yeah, right. Yeah. So. I mean, if you mix them up too much on the palette. It just starts looking too contrived, so I kind of let the knife mix them as it's going on there. So it's risky. I do a lot of scraping too.
Yeah.
It's not just painting; it's scraping. Ooh, that looks terrible! Scrape that off.
Take that out of there. Yeah, we don't want that.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. So the other thing that you are known for is also en plein air.
Yes. Yes.
Which is painting on site.
Right.
So you do that quite a lot, and you do it at a lot of different places too.
Yeah, well, it's kind of like I've always wanted to move somewhere else, but since I couldn't, now I do competitions in all these places that I like to visit. Yeah. And it's really great because it's usually an organization, and they hold it like at a museum or a gallery or something, and they always give you a host family to stay with. Mm-hmm. And so it's just a matter of getting there, and then you have a place to stay. And it's usually in beautiful places, you know, like mm-hmm. San Luis Obispo or Laguna Beach, California, or, you know, Jupiter, Florida. And there's just like, I was just in Atlanta, Georgia in the spring, so I get to explore all these different places for a week.
That's great, though.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun.
It's like a vacation.
Well, people say that. They'll say like, oh, enjoy your vacation, but they don't realize, like, we work really, really hard.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
It's like kind of stressful, and I've been doing them for 10 years now, so I'm thinking that maybe it's time to phase them out a little bit. But it is how I make my living, so I have to be careful. Mm-hmm. But they're stressful because, you know, there's like 30 or 40 artists, and they're all trying to paint their best paintings, and you want to paint your best paintings, and you want to sell them, and you'd like to win a prize, so it's kind of, you know, it's pretty stressful. It's not like we're vacationing.
Well, it keeps you on your toes. Is really what it is.
I paint more when I'm on those things than any time ever. Like, I might paint two in a day, you know, mm-hmm. two small paintings. So it's, mm-hmm. yeah, but it was a great way to travel, meet lots of new people, gather collectors, and it's been, you know, really mm-hmm. a great thing to do.
So generally, your sizes are kind of like like mid-range. They're not really small, but they're not really big, and they're easy to travel with.
They're like anywhere from 8x10 to the biggest I've painted was 24x36. Because I was starting to get bored with, you know, doing the little ones, so I was trying mm-hmm. to do big ones, and that's a struggle. But
do you find that you change the size of the knife or the palette when you're the palette knife or the
I
scraper?
Use the same one all the time. It's mm-hmm. like 3 inches long, but you can just use less paint.
Oh,
because mm-hmm. they're more flexible. If you use a little tiny one, then they're really stiff and they're hard mm-hmm. to maneuver. So.
Yeah, yeah. I never have any fun with those small ones. I draw with them, you know.
Yeah. Okay.
So that's you know, like I get one that's a half an inch wide, and right. then I'll draw with it.
Well, it's funny. I have like maybe 50 different sizes because I keep thinking, oh, I should try this one. I should try this one. But it's always that same one. I just mm-hmm. end up gravitating towards. So.
That's one you feel right with.
Right. Yeah.
So and as part of your practice, you've also written a couple of books.
I have, yes.
And you're teaching, and you have like we're still pretty early in the program here, but you have a couple of instructional DVDs mm-hmm. that you've been promoting. How can we go in on this? Is that a possibility? Or do you have to do that out here?
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Well, the DVDs were produced by Plein Air magazine. And mm-hmm. It was, you know, it was mm-hmm. fun. It was a little nerve-wracking. But I did two of them about 2 years ago, I guess.
And this is the other one.
One's done plein air, like at a place, that one, and the other one was done in the studio.
Uh-huh. Very cool. So many of the images too, when you started out on this one particular program, you had you were painting conversations.
Oh, right.
Yeah. So it was all between women,
right,
mostly.
Right.
Mm-hmm. They were sitting at tables, cafes, patios, and
right.
just communicating with each other and sharing
yeah.
sharing your intimacies as women.
That was my first theme, and what happened was in 1996 or 7, I guess, I was taking classes with Tara Grimm at the Wyomissing Institute, and somehow it came about that there was this woman named Barbara Doherty that did marketing. So I went down and met with her in 1997, and she was like this marketing guru who had a magazine called Art Calendar. And mm-hmm. for a certain fee, I went there and spent the whole weekend, and we talked about what I did. And I was showing her paintings I was working on, and they were all these women in conversations, which were my friends. And So we kind of talked about it, and we came up with this theme, The Art of Conversation, which has been my theme now for forever, because there's almost always people in my paintings, you know.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So she was great, and she passed away about three years ago. But we worked together for 18 years, and she was just fabulous. She would, like, push me to do things I didn't want to do. You know, like, she'd say, well, you should teach. And I'd be like, no, I don't want to. And so I did, and I ended up really enjoying it. And she would tell me to do these things, and she helped me produce these two books. So that's how they came about, because otherwise I would have never done that, you know.
Right.
But
right.
It ended up being a good thing. So.
I'm sure. That's his... You know, is it, The Art of Conversation and The Art of Conversation Manhattan.
Yes.
So did you, so you spent a lot of time in New York then?
Yeah, when I was a junior at Kutztown, I went to Kutztown University. Mm-hmm. And there was a competition where you had to promote your college. So, and it was for an advertising agency in Manhattan. So I said that Kutztown was the best of both worlds because it's in the country and it's rural and it's beautiful. But it's close to Manhattan because you could get the Bieber bus at that time.
At that, yeah.
Yeah, I guess you still can. Yeah. But
so Bieber.
Yeah.
But still.
But anyway, so I had designed this. I was a graphic design major. This tree that had on one side rural scenes, on the other side the city, and I ended up winning. So I won $1,000, which was a really, really big deal in college.
It was a big deal in college.
And it was a 6-week internship at this agency in Manhattan.
Mm-hmm.
So I was just this 20-year-old, like, totally, like, not knowing what was going on, wide-eyed, you know. But mm-hmm. I ended up kind of falling in love with the city and, like, just growing up in the country, being a country girl, I was just, like, infatuated with the city. So I go up a lot. In fact, I was just up Monday and Tuesday, and it's just a whole different world, and it's interesting, and the people are interesting. So
mm-hmm.
So that's why I came up with the idea of doing the second book, which they were all done from photographs, so they're really tight and really realistic, which is not really how I wanted to paint. I wanted to paint more impressionistic.
Mm-hmm.
So when I met Barb, she said, well, you should do plein air painting. And I was like, what's that? You know, I didn't even know. I mean, I had previously painted outside before with the Burke's Art Alliance, but I didn't know it had a name, you know, plein air painting, which is really just French for painting in the open air.
Right.
And so I started plein air painting, and then my stuff got looser, which is more what I wanted.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, because you're outside, the sun's changing, you have, like, just a few hours, so you have to paint fast.
So you're pretty limited. You've got a number of different, what do they call it, limitations. You know, that you only have, like you said, they only have so much sunlight.
Right.
And then you're working it with oils, so you have all this equipment.
Oh, yeah, it's like, it's crazy. And you also have, like, I've already been painting outside somewhere, and all of a sudden a storm comes, and it's raining, and it's thundering, and it's lightning, and you're, like, grabbing all your stuff, or you'll see a storm coming, you're like, I gotta hurry. So you paint, like, really intuitively. You're not, like, fussing and drawing every line, because you can't.
And measuring, you know.
Yeah, so it gives it an energy, and I like that. So the first event I did was 2006 in Annapolis, Maryland, and I just entered, and I got in, which I was shocked, and I didn't know what anybody else did. I just went out, like, very naively, and I painted this big cafe scene, like, this big, and it was really loose and really bad. If I could see it right now, I would probably die if someone showed it to me right now. But what ended up happening, I went to the opening, and everybody had these really small, muted, like, boat scenes and landscapes, and here I am with this big, bright cafe scene. I was like, oh, my God. I was so embarrassed, you know, like, to even have it hanging on the wall. But it ended up winning second prize.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, my God, I'm going to do these more often. So I, like, signed up for them all over the country. And I really learned a lot. I met a lot of great, interesting people. And, I mean, I know a lot of top artists from all over the country that I get to paint with. And it's just, it's been really fun and really fabulous. But I am tiring of it after 10 years because now there's this crop of new younger people coming up, and they're, like, really, their stuff is different and it's big and it's wilder, and I'm like, whoa, you know, I don't know if I can compete with that anymore. And it's just getting a little tiring, but
I think it gets to a certain time in your life when you just feel that maybe you gotta throttle back a little.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So it's been great, and I still, you know, we'll do a couple more. I'm doing one in Florida in March, and I always do the Wayne one down here on the mainland.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
That's a good one. And So there's, oh, I do one in Jackson Hole, which who wouldn't want to go to Wyoming, you know, in July. Ooh, yeah. I did that one 3 years, but I think I'm going to take a break this year. So it's, oh, you know, it's been fun, but it gets a little tiring of packing and unpacking. So
And the traveling, yeah, and all that.
So my goal this summer had been to stay home more, but it was a miserable summer with the weather and the humidity and the rain. But
yeah, this was not the most congenial of summers.
Right, right.
I could say, I used to do that kind of thing myself. Used to go out and paint out in the open.
Oh, okay.
But what happened was that it always ended up that I would always veer from what I wanted to do and end up abstracting it or fooling around with it and stuff.
Yeah.
And then it would turn out to be something totally different than what I had intended to begin with. And
right.
I thought, nah, this isn't really my thing. And one time I went to do some, I went and I made a drawing. I was over at Green's Mill.
Okay.
And we had a big group of people out there all doing drawings and paintings and stuff.
Right.
And I did this big drawing that of the mill out there.
Okay. Yeah,
and then what happened was the wind crept up.
Oh.
And it blew a branch right through the drawing.
Oh, you're kidding.
Yeah. So I was like, okay, I ain't doing this anymore.
Yeah. No, it's like I taught a class in plein air painting a couple years ago, and the one woman said, "This is like a sport. You have to be like an athlete to do this."
We have a home viewer. Somebody actually called.
Wow.
All right. Well, hello.
Hi. How are you?
Good. How about you?
Very well. I caught the beginning, and I'm just wondering if I heard correctly. Are you primarily a you paint with a palette knife?
Yes. Yeah. Both.
Is that like you do that exclusively, or do you also do work with brushes and so on?
Well, I do both, and people ask that all the time. I generally start the painting with my brush, and I draw it in, and I get it all figured out, and I might get the colors blocked in, and then I'll go over it and do it with the palette knife. Sometimes it ends up being totally done with a palette knife, but...
Well, that leads me to my... I'm very happy to... I've never heard anyone talk about the palette knife. Being a former art student myself, it was one of the least favorite things to try and tackle.
Oh, yeah.
But it seemed to me that there is a similarity between working with a palette knife and watercolors, even though they seem dissimilar. But I see them similar in the following, that for both watercolors and palette knife, you must really plan and think ahead of what you're going to do.
Okay, yeah, that's true. I think the similarity I see is that watercolors, sometimes you don't have a lot of control. It's where the water goes. And with a knife, you don't have a lot of control. Sometimes I just let it up to the painting universe or something. Mm-hmm. Like, you do things, and it's like, oh, that looks really cool. I'm going to leave that go.
Now, when you work with the palette knife, one of the advantages of that is that you can add a lot of texture naturally to your paintings.
Right. Yep.
Whereas with a brush you've got to add that texture via lights and darks and colorizing and so on. But with the palette knife, there's just a natural texture to it.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
And do you think that the palette knife paintings with a lot of texture, because depending upon the palette knife you use, you can get a lot of texture, can't you?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Like, I recall one palette knife in class was a fairly short palette knife with a 90-degree bend in it close to the blade.
Okay.
And you applied a lot of paint with it. You went through a lot of paint, which didn't always please the instructor. But with that, you got a lot of texture. And it seemed that sometimes the viewers of palette work were a bit turned off with the palette knife painting versus with the typical brush.
Well, you have to do it. You can't put too much paint on or it gets like in the way.
Yeah.
So if it's not the central focus, you don't want really thick paint. So I try to Like this was a West Reading scene at the corner. Yeah,
we have an example here.
I figured you wouldn't. I'm just going to ask one more question for both of you, and then I'll get off and listen to your answers, and I'm anxious to see your paintings. With two of Van Gogh's very famous paintings, Starry, Starry Night and his self-portrait, were they done with a brush just using a lot of paint, or did he also dabble with the palette knife in his artwork?
Oh, I'm pretty sure he used the palette knife. I guess none of us really know for sure, but I think
he primarily used the brush loaded with paint.
Yeah.
Occasionally he used the palette knife, but
yeah.
for the most part, he was pretty much of a brush person.
Is that why those paintings I mentioned have that palette knife look, a lot of texture?
Yeah, I think some of his portraits that I had seen, it really looked like a knife, or maybe he just had such old brushes that they were like stumps.
Because he wasn't a very wealthy man.
Right.
He used a lot of brushes that just were pretty...
Okay, well, I'll let you go. Thank you so much.
Well,
a very interesting program.
If you have
any other questions, please.
No, I probably do, but I'll let you get on with your artwork.
All right. Thank you. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thanks for calling. So we have a couple of examples, some real paintings here that were done with a palette knife. And if you wanted, if we could get a zoom in on this, I hate to make you run out here again from our control room personnel who are so cooperative with us. We just make them crazy. But anyway, this is a scene in West Reading. Where it's like on the corner of 5th and Penn. And, here we go. And this is all done with a palette knife. Everything is done with a knife. So, it takes a good eye. I think that it takes a good eye to capture this kind of stuff, especially when you're composing it directly onto the canvas. On the board in this case.
Yeah, like he had asked about brush and knife. And, I don't just start painting with a knife. I draw it with a brush, and I kind of do like a value painting with the brush.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I have it the way I like it, then I start getting at it with the knife. Yeah.
I shouldn't assume.
Well,
but yeah.
A lot of people ask me, is it 100% palette knife? Like, I'm like, well, no, I don't know. Sometimes it needs a brush,
mm-hmm.
Sometimes a brush is better, so.
Mm-hmm. Well, we have a couple more images here if you want to see these.
Yeah, maybe just one of those.
Okay. Which one?
That front one. The one you like.
The one I like, yeah. Yeah.
So this was doing a series of self-portraits. Let's kind of make sure there's no glare on it. There we go. There we go. So, with myself, I can do it with the palette knife and not worry so much about offending anyone, like, did I make them look ugly or anything. So, it's kind of fun doing my own, and I'm starting to do more other people with the...
That's like Marilyn Fox said to me the other day, does this painting make me look fat?
Oh, that's funny. Yeah. Yeah, so anyway, I just brought a couple of those around.
So let's go to a couple of the other images. What do you think?
Okay, mm-hmm. Sure.
Okay. Yes. So this one, what's it? Does this have a title?
I think that one so far is called A Face in the Crowd.
Ah.
So what I was doing a lot of Manhattan scenes, and then I thought, well, I'm starting to explore. I mean, I've been painting faceless people for years where they're just like, figures with, the swash where the face is. So I thought, I'm going to start painting people's faces. So I would take, these are from photographs, they're not plein air. This is a 30-inch by 30-inch painting. But I would like look at the photo and then, or multiple photos, and just pick a person and zoom in on them like they're like walking towards you. And a lot of times when you're taking pictures in the city, there is someone staring at you because they're wondering why you're taking a picture of them.
Mm-hmm.
So so I started, this is where my new series that I'm working on now, which we'll talk about later, started just by, capturing a couple people in the crowd. And then this is a big 40-inch by 40-inch Manhattan scene where I'm just trying to show the action. So when they get bigger like that, it's not quite as much palette knife, just because I would need like so much paint to fill that up. There's parts that are palette knife and parts that are brush. And I use squeegees and all kinds of other tools that...
And oil paint is expensive.
It is.
Lately, oil paint is very expensive. Yes. I mean, if you and if you're a fan of paints like Gamblin or some of these others, where you could spend as much as $30 for one tube of paint, that's expensive.
I am an art ambassador for Royal Talons, which makes Rembrandt and Cobra, and they give me like a certain amount of paint each year, but it's it's usually gone by March or April, so it goes pretty fast.
It does.
Now this was a painting that I started in Key West of a friend of mine, and it got to the point where I didn't know how to finish it, so I stopped, and I kind of like it unfinished, so I don't know. What's been interesting about doing studio paintings is there are like, 30 of them in my house where I don't know if they're done yet. Like the plein air paintings, you go out, you paint it when it looks like the spot, then you stop and you take it home. But these are different, and they're really a lot harder.
It's very difficult to know when to stop.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you can kill a painting.
Exactly. Yes.
Really. By
so when I'm at home in the luxury of my studio, I stop and put it aside and start another one or something.
Thank you, Joan.
Which works well. And this was another one I had started about the same time. It's 30 by 30, and it was myself. And there was a reflection of me in it. And then I started doing, there was a tree behind it, and it was kind of indicating, it's called, what is this one called now? I can't remember. Oh, on a winter's day. So every year I go to Key West, and I stand at my window, and I watch I think they're robins, and they come to this winterberry tree, and they eat all the berries, and they fly away. And that's always kind of meaning to me that it's time for me to go south too, so.
Yeah.
So that one, I don't know if that one's finished either. I don't think it is, but it's where I was experimenting with the palette knife. And this is a really recent one I did actually on Saturday. This was a demo for the class I was teaching at the Yoakum Institute. Mm-hmm. So I take a photo and I show other artists how I transcribe that into a palette knife painting, and that's done very much like a plein air painting would be done, where I only have like an hour and a half or 2 hours to do a painting.
Yeah, but in some ways it's just the sheer sensual quality of the paint.
Of the paint. Yeah.
I mean, sometimes that just means everything. I mean, when you look at it, and if it creates the right illusion. Like this one draws you right into the house. I mean, it's like you get the idea of the space in front of it, which is pretty abstracted actually, and cut down to a bunch of just narrow strokes and gestures. But then when you get a little closer, when you see the actual paint, and you get close up to it, it looks different because the physicality of the paint really adds to the image. And I think that this is...
Well, I've been, art is like a never-ending learning process. Like, the more I learn, the more I don't know. The more I know that I need to learn. So just this past recent, maybe a year and a half ago, I studied composition with Victor from, I think you might have met him.
Oh, yeah.
Academy of Composition. But he helped a lot because I was usually just painting what I saw. So here I have the road that draws your eye up to the house. The front is dark, so it's like a frame around. So I've been learning a lot about composition, color, values. What I think I really need to study more is color. But, like I said, the more I learn, the more I know that I need to learn more. So it's like this never-ending thing. Which is great.
And unlearning is just as important,
too. Oh, yeah. It's really hard to unlearn something.
Yeah. It's like I saw something on television that I wished I wouldn't have seen, so how do you unsee something,
right? Yeah, exactly.
You know.
But that's what's great about art. Like, even, I know artists that are, in their 80s, and they'll say, I'm starting to get a couple of them right, It's like artists are never satisfied with what they do, and that's a good thing, I think, if you got happy with what you did and you get painting the same thing. It would be really boring.
Well, there's a up at the Betty Cunningham Gallery right now, there's a really excellent exhibit of artwork by Rackstraw Downs.
Oh, okay.
Oh, my God.
Really?
Yeah. And the guys, the guy, they said that this he painted this one painting at a young 77 years old. So, you know,
yeah.
I think he's all, you know, like he and artists that work in this capacity are always continually working to improve themselves.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah. Which I think is why a lot of artists live longer, because we're so passionate about what we do and trying to learn all the time. And,
So let's go to the next one here. Now, this is part of your latest series
of
work, right?
Yeah. So I'll kind of explain my newest series. This was the first one. And what happened was I was doing all these plein air paintings. And, you know, I'm thinking, well, this is great. I'm like, I can spit out these little paintings and go out and paint some paintings and paint some more paintings. And I'm painting what I see, but I started feeling like I wanted to paint more like from within, something that had part of me or part of my soul in it, not just like something that I see. I wanted to paint something that was inside of me. And I spent like a year and a half, you know, talking to friends and like, what do I want to paint? I don't know. Like, I just couldn't. I wanted to paint something deeper than just what I see, but I didn't know what it was. So I thought, well, I'll start painting myself. And maybe by staring at myself in the mirror numerous times, I will figure out what it is that I want to paint. So I started doing these self-portraits, and and then I thought, well, maybe I'll do a series on Native American, because supposedly that's in my background. And I went up to New York, and I researched Native Americans, I researched my name, got nowhere. So I was like, okay, well, maybe I'm not Native American, but I don't look anything like I am. But so then I started...
Like Elizabeth Warren?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm related to Pocahontas. But no, I mean, supposedly there really is some in there, but I couldn't find anything. So then I thought, well, then the whole immigration thing started happening, and I started thinking about where people are from, and does it really matter where we're from? Like, we all came from somewhere.
Yeah.
And then I started thinking, well, where did I come from? So I got my DNA tested with three different companies, because I thought I want to know a little bit more about what I am, you know, where I came from. So what I found out was... kind of what I thought, a little bit of lots of things, but mostly Swiss, French, German, a little Scandinavian. One place said Greek, one didn't. One said part Jewish, one didn't, which I'm not even sure why that was there. And then a lot of them say a little bit of England, Ireland, Welsh. So, you know, I'm just a mixture of lots of things. So,
Of what my father used to call a Heinz 57.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So then I started thinking of, I somehow got on the Gustav Klimt, who is Austrian, by the way. I guess you know that. And all his patterns and textures, and I just kind of really got infatuated with his work. So I started looking at his book and just taking some poses. So that was actually the same pose that he used in something called, I don't know what it was called, The Florist or something. I don't know, but she was holding a vase of flowers, so... I'm holding a bunch of knives and brushes in my thing. And that was painted from looking in a mirror in my studio. And I really enjoyed it. So I thought, oh, I'm going to start painting different people from different nationality backgrounds. And so I started painting people from, you know, different areas. And so I started with like one of my best friends, Laura, who is from Italian descent. And she came over and brought clothing and I painted her, and so now I'm doing this whole series because the thought is that we are all like a thread to this giant tapestry called humanity, and we're all just piece of this big, you know, universe, and we're all the same. So now I'm doing this show in Alvernia in January, and it's going to be all these, they're 2 feet by 3 feet, full-size portraits of, and I'm going to do women to start because we're the ones that bear the children, and then... So I'm really excited about it, and just the people I've met and the things I've learned. I did a Vietnamese woman last week, and I learned all about her culture and where her family was from, and I did a woman before that was part Lebanese, and her other part of her family was from Jerusalem, and they bring their clothing and their different things, like the woman from Vietnam has a dress her grandmother gave her with a peacock on, a big hat, and It's just been fun, like learning and getting people's reactions to the mm-hmm. other paintings, and it's just been really fascinating.
And also, it's like some of the portraits are defined by the objects that are around, that are surrounding right. the people that you're painting.
Right.
See, like in this image, towards the left of the image, there's a jar that is semi-transparent. It's got some brushes and things in it, but for the same token, that jar explains as much about you as your actual portrait.
And some of the things in that painting, like I'm holding a Dundee marmalade jar, and then the other one has like an Asian-looking vase, and they're things that were in my house when I was growing up. They're like mm-hmm. things that remind me of myself growing up. Mm-hmm. So, and the people that I'm painting, I'm also putting symbolism of, you know, where they're from, what country they're from. Their ancestry is from. So it's been really.
Do you think there's any kind of political commentary on that? Do you think?
Yes, for
yeah?
sure.
Yeah. Considering all the hatred of immigrants going on.
Because I mean, we all immigrated from somewhere. You know,
honestly,
all of us. So.
Mm-hmm. So I'll go to the next one here.
That's the one I was speaking of, my friend Laura, and in the background is, it's a. Portrait of Italian immigrants in the background. This one's more subtle. There's also none of the ones that I've done so far are finished, I don't consider, but there's a little bit of symbolism behind her shoulder, and it's mm-hmm. something I found on the internet that's Italian symbol. And, you know, I'm not so sure how far I'm going to take all these or how crazy I'm going to get with the symbols, but it's been a learning experience. And I have a mm-hmm. feeling that the more of these I do, the more I'll be like taking them off the wall and changing them, and you know.
Well,
I don't know.
I have a friend of mine who says that the painting's never done until it leaves the studio.
Oh, that's how mine are.
Yeah.
Because I'll have it sitting in, you know, like my living room is basically my studio. But I'll walk by, and if the sun's hitting it a certain way, I'll be like, oh, look at that. Maybe I should change that. And I'll grab it off the wall and mm-hmm. change it, you know.
Yeah.
So.
Oh, that's it. You see, but that's the plight of an artist, you know?
Yeah.
It's never complete.
Right.
It's never enough.
So that's another woman. So it's been like this, everybody says, how do you get the models? Where it's just like, I'll tell, like I told Laura, and she's like, oh, well, Amy works with me, and, you know, she's African-American, and she came over dressed like that, and I was like, oh, my God, this is great, you know? So we talked, mm-hmm. and I learned about her, and then the background is the Balboa tree. It's the symbolism of... symbol of life in Africa, and there's every little symbol in there means something. So I kind of really went crazy with the symbols on that one. Mm-hmm. So, you know, as they go, I don't know what'll happen. I've been experimenting with rollers and brayers and mm-hmm. squeegees, and it's just been kind of fun.
Making references.
Yeah.
But doing it in a way that is, I mean, the textures of it too, like saying earlier, like the physical presence of these paintings are just really... really strong.
Yeah, so it's been fun. And so then, like, these beautiful women come, and then I'm afraid to use a palette knife on their faces. You know, it's like, oh, you know, I can't do that. Yeah. So today I was working on my friend Jan, and she's like, I want you to do that to me. I want you to use the palette knife. So I'm just starting that one, and I don't have a picture of it. But so I'm going to continue to paint more artists that I know that I can feel comfortable using the palette knife. Then I'll start painting strangers again. I think that's my plan. Oh, now this one's from Cuba when I went there two and a half years ago. And that's a small 9 by 12 or 10 by 12. And it's really loose because we were, it was a tour. There was like 100 artists, and it was kind of crazy. We had very limited time. Like, the bus would drop us off and say, all right, meet you here in an hour and a half. So it was like this panic attack, like, do a painting fast, you know.
In an hour and a half.
Yeah.
Wow.
So they're all like super loose, but that's the kind of stuff that stretches you. You know, mm-hmm. you're kind of painting like on the fly, and whatever happens, happens. And it's kind of like, but that was one of my favorite ones from there.
Well, that's like life drawing. Like,
yes, exactly.
If you're in a life drawing class in school, they'll start you up with like warm up. They'll say, okay, we're going to have 20 second sketches.
Yeah.
You know, so you got a group of 20 second sketch, and then it'll jump to 2 minutes, and then it'll jump to 5 minutes, and then it'll jump to 10. And,
yeah.
You know.
And those are great. I still go to the Goggle Works occasionally on Tuesdays to do that, because it's mm-hmm. a really good way to loosen up, just with a pencil or whatever mm-hmm. you have. Yeah.
Charcoal, yep.
Oh, and this was the one I did of the Reading Symphony. About 2 years ago, the previous director of the Reading Symphony asked me, he saw me painting a quartet, the Sweet Plantains were playing in Reading, and he saw me painting live, and he said, oh, could you paint the symphony? And I was like, oh, sure, you know.
Mm-hmm, really?
So then it ended up being that he wanted me to paint a 2 feet by 3 feet painting of the symphony while they were playing, and I was like, oh, that sounds kind of overwhelming, but okay, sure. So.
That's Sydney, right? Sydney Rothstein?
No, that's yeah. Andrew Constantine.
Andrew Constantine, yeah.
So anyway, it ended up being this really big thing where I stood up on the balcony. So then they got a new director in the meantime, and he was like, so what are you doing? We're doing this, so what's the plan? And I was like, well, you know, I'm going to stand. I kind of got to pick whatever I wanted to do. I went to stand up on the side box and look down on it.
Mm-hmm.
So I stood up there and painted a 24 by 30 inch painting while the symphony played, and they had a camera on me, and then they had a big screen that came down over the symphony where they were showing me painting. So it sounds like insane, and all year long I couldn't even think about it. I was like, I can't even think about that, because mm-hmm. it made me so nervous. But then I went the week before while they were practicing and did a practice painting up there. Mm-hmm. So I knew that I could do it, and I kind of planned it out with a couple lines, like where it would be, and yeah, and then that's what I did, and then they sold it off at an auction to benefit the symphony, and it was really invigorating and satisfying when it was over, you know.
When it was over,
yeah.
Right.
And that night it was fun as well, mm-hmm. and, you know, friends of mine came. And
well, it's just like a performance. I mean, it actually is a performance, just as the music is going on, your activity as a painter is happening right along in conjunction with it, so that's a...
But it was their idea, because they were playing pictures of an exhibition from Mussorgsky.
Mm-hmm.
And so they thought they would have a picture while they were playing it. So I asked them if, I think the piece is 20 minutes long. I said, well, I can't do a painting in 20 minutes. So they stretched it out to 45 minutes. And I got to paint during the intermission and the beginning and the end. So, you know, I probably had an hour and a half or 2 hours. And the next day I tweaked it a little bit, and then they sold it the next night. So it was really, really fun.
Very nice.
Yeah.
Very nice. So these are all canvases. Is it stretch canvas?
That was a stretch canvas, yeah. Mm-hmm. Some of the bigger ones are, I like panels because you can scrape them down and get crazy with them. But
They're more
but they're heavy
cooperative
too.
With the,
So. That was another Cuba one where I didn't have very much time, but it was fun. You know, it was loose and wild and...
Yeah, I like that. That's a rich red, and then you get the idea of the street life in Cuba, because, you know, there's these guys in the white waiter shirts and the laundry hanging from the lines.
Oh, yeah, laundry was everywhere there. Yeah, yeah, it was an interesting place. Yeah, it was fun to paint there, and the people were so friendly. They just loved that we were there painting. They're very artistic, very intelligent people down there.
Mm-hmm.
I have a new respect for them.
So, and I think that was the last one.
Okay.
So let's talk a little bit about your future, maybe.
Okay.
Or you want to read your statement?
Yeah, I could read my statement. Basically, I think I've pretty much talked about what all of that is. I mean, okay, I'll read a little bit of it. It says that I spent the past 12 years plein air painting and traveling all over the country, but now I want to paint, you know, rather than an impression of the scene, I want to paint like what's within. Mm-hmm. And I have always loved to paint portraits. Like, I have a basement full of 12 by 12 or 12 by 16 inch portraits, because I go to the institute or wherever I can and paint live models, because I've always liked that. But I don't want to be a commissioned portrait painter, because I think that, like, when I look in the mirror, when you look in the mirror, you see a certain thing. And for me to paint what you see, I just think it would be like really, really difficult.
Yeah.
So I've never wanted to do that, like commission portraits, I don't think.
No.
Unless they want themselves crazy in the palette knife.
Yeah. I used to commission portraits, but then everybody doesn't see themselves the way you see them.
Exactly.
You're being very, how would you say, non-objective. So
right.
you don't have really anything personal to gain by showing their noses the same size it is.
Right.
But other people say to me, my nose doesn't look like that.
Oh, yeah. So I never really wanted to do portrait commissions. But so now with this new thing,
Okay, we got a home viewer.
Okay.
So let's chat with them. Hi.
Hi, I don't want to disappoint you, but it's me again.
No. Oh, no, it's him again.
Now that I've seen your artwork, I wanted to pay you some compliments.
Okay.
Your artwork is excellent. It is superb.
Well, thank you.
And I'm visually impaired to a large degree, so I can't see how vivid the colors are, but it seems that you use a lot of muted colors. Am I correct?
No.
No? Okay, then that's my vision.
Okay.
Then I want to let you know that the way you explain things, the rationale behind your paintings, is so down to earth, it's almost unheard of in the art world. And thirdly, not once tonight have you used the word organic, which seems to be a commonly used word in the art field. Everything is organic.
Okay.
And finally, for as talented a person as you are the least pretentious, talented person I think who's ever appeared on this program. And finally, for the viewers, anyone else, I'm not related to this woman.
Oh, yeah.
And I don't even know her, but it was delightful tuning in tonight.
Well, thank you. Wow.
No, cool. Thank you. Thanks for calling in.
Well, that's interesting because when I teach workshops, see, I don't have a master's degree. I'm not really good at the wording and using organic and all that kind of stuff. So I just say what I think, which is usually basic, simple words, you know.
Right.
So, because
right.
That's how I teach and that's how I relate to people. And I've taken classes where people, you know, are expounding all these words and then it's like, and I think a lot of students are used to that, and I just kind of very down-to-earth teach. So.
Yeah, but a lot of people are put off by it, too.
Yeah.
You know, they'll agree with it, and they'll say yes, and all that. But when an artist comes off as being too, you know, too good on themselves, you know.
But I'm not good on myself because I don't usually feel really good about my work, you know. It's like, I'm really hard on myself. I really am, and I don't know. I guess that's good and bad. But
well, it's probably good because you're constantly aware of your possible shortcomings.
Oh yeah, there's lots of those.
Yeah,
so.
I mean, it's not, well, you know, nobody's perfect.
Right.
But. So.
Yeah. So anyway, I'll finish this. Let's see. So anyway, I was saying about I wanted to go deeper and you know trying all different. I mean. Actually, I already said everything that's on there. Mm-hmm. So I'll just read this very short thing. This is my statement of my new series, and it's, I feel very strongly that we are all minute threads from a huge tapestry called humanity. I want to know these threads and make a connection with the people I paint. I'm starting with the women of Berks County. I'm meeting women who are proud of their heritage and painting them. I want to examine the culture and power of the women that I paint. We are the ones who bear the children that carry our heritage. So I am on a quest. So if anyone out there loves their heritage and is proud of it and wants to display it, I am taking anyone who wants to volunteer to pose for me.
There you go.
So
that's
my new series. And I mean, what I really like about the whole thought of it is that when I have a reception, like I envision, I research, there's 195 countries in the world. I don't think that I will paint all of those, I know, realistically. Mm-hmm. But I'd like to paint like maybe 50 and then have, like I don't think this is going to end with my show at Alburnia. I want to just keep going and going and going.
Keep going, yeah.
And then like I'll have a reception and there'll be people from countries all over the world in the same room talking to each other that may never happen. And I just think that's like so cool. I love that idea.
It's wonderful.
So that's my quest, is to just to continue painting this series as long as I can afford to, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm not selling these, so it's not like I'm making any money. So I also have to continue painting.
Well, who knows? Some auction house will buy them all up.
Well, I don't know. But, you know, so that's where I'm at with my career. It's a little daunting. Like, I make money when I do you know, the plein air things, usually, not always. I've had a few mm-hmm. write-in cell thing. But so I have to keep a balance of painting things that will sell as well as painting these newer things. So it's, you know, mm-hmm. it has me a little, I'm not losing sleep, but I think about that.
Yeah. Well, you always have the next project in mind.
Right.
Yeah. So this show that's taking place at Alvernia.
Yes.
That's going to be this January?
January 14th. It's opening. It's a Monday.
Yeah. So for all of you folks out there that really want to get a close-up of this work and come to see it in person, come over to Alvernia University in Francis Hall on the campus at St. Bernardine Street over there off of, near Kenhurst.
Yeah.
And come on in.
It's a really nice gallery, and it's not real big, so it's not too daunting. Right. And I'm just going to do as many as I can. And then I'm also doing a 60 by 60 inch. I stretched the canvas, and it's sitting in my living room staring at me every day. I haven't done anything, but it's going to be a huge tapestry with one woman, I'm not sure who, and symbolism of how we're all threads, and I don't know exactly how I'm going to do it. So, but I still have November, December, and 2 weeks in January to get these done. So
I look forward yeah. to it. I look forward to it very much.
I am too. So.
Should we show the other portrait here?
Yeah, sure.
We have two here. It looks like.
Yeah, the first one was when I was thinking that I was Native American heritage, and I don't know if you can see that without a glare. That's probably better. But there we go. Yeah. But then after a while, I was like, well, I may not be Native American at all. So. So then this was the next one. I think the one I showed earlier was the third one. Well, actually, there's many, many more, but this is another one where I just stare at myself and try to paint what's in there. My mother always says, or people have said, why don't you smile? My mother says, make yourself look prettier. But it's like, that's what I see when I look in there. I see the bags and the wrinkles. And
I'm smiling at the picture.
And you can't smile and do a self-portrait, believe me. Your cheeks start shaking, and it's just really difficult. So.
Oh yeah. Well, you can't. You know. By the time you readjust, I mean, you look at yourself, and then you have to go to the canvas, and you look at yourself.
It's
and
really,
you
really
to the
hard.
Canvas,
yeah. You know. It's really hard.
So it's not like you have a subject in front of you.
Right.
That you can continually refer to.
Exactly. And then you start looking like really intensely at yourself because you're staring, and then you get this weird look on your face. So yeah, it's tough.
Yeah, you can't avoid that sometimes.
Right.
So we have a little bit of time left here.
Oh, okay.
Maybe like 3 minutes or so. 1 minute.
1 minute.
Okay. Well, this is going to end pretty quick on us.
Yeah. Okay.
So I think really what I want to do is before we get cut off here, I want to thank you.
Thank you
for being on.
It's my pleasure. I mean, I don't get to talk about my art a whole lot, you know, so.
Well, I've been seeing your work around, and I thought, it's time for an evaluation.
Thank you.
Bring you out into the open more. I mean, even though you have been out in the open. I mean, that one painting of your self-portrait that we were studying earlier was in the, was that the Berks Arts?
The Berks Art Alliance show at the Goggle Works. Yeah.
That won an award, though, didn't it? Didn't that win an award?
No.
No?
The only award it got was you mentioned it in the newspaper, yeah.
Oh.
So thank you for that.
Sure, absolutely. Yeah, because that's, I like your work, and I'd like to see more of it.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that.
And what was it? Was this the last? Did we see this one?
Yeah, that was the first one.
That was the first one, right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Now we are given the goodbye signal here. So thanks again.
Okay.
Thank you, Michele.
Thank you. It was great. Thanks, Ron.
It was great. Thanks for being here. Yeah.
Okay.
And thank you all for joining us. This is NAP Connections. I'm Ron Schira with Michele Byrne. And have a wonderful evening.
NAP Connection originates from the Berks Community Television Studio in Reading, PA, airing live on the fourth Tuesday of the month at 9 p.m. Check your local listings for repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts Program, call 610-683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530, or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown. Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5 p.m., Saturday, 10 to 2 p.m., or by appointment.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.